Section 1 of On the Incarnation. On the Incarnation by Athanasius of Alexandria. Translated by Archibald Robertson. Whereas, in what precedes, we have drawn out, choosing a few points from among many, a sufficient account of the error of the heathen concerning idols, and of the worship of idols, and how they originally came to be invented. How, namely, out of wickedness, men devised for themselves the worshipping of idols, and whereas we have, by God's grace, noted somewhat also of the divinity of the word of the Father, and of his universal providence and power, and that the good Father, through him, orders all things, and all things are moved by him, and in him are quickened. Come now, Macarius, worthy of that name, and true lover of Christ, let us follow up the faith of our religion, and set forth also what relates to the Word's becoming man, and to his divine appearing amongst us, which Jews traduce, and Greeks laugh to scorn, but we worship, in order that, all the more for the seeming low estate of the Word, your piety towards him may be increased and multiplied. For the more he is mocked among the unbelieving, the more witness does he give of his own Godhead, inasmuch as he not only himself demonstrates as possible what men mistake, thinking impossible, but what men deride as unseemly, this by his own goodness he clothes with seemliness, and what men in their conceit of wisdom laugh at as merely human, he by his own power demonstrates to be divine, subduing the pretensions of idols by his supposed humiliation, by the cross, and by those who mock and disbelieve, invisibly winning over to recognize his divinity and power. But to treat this subject, it is necessary to recall what has been previously said, in order that you may neither fail to know the cause of the bodily appearing of the word of the Father, so high and so great, nor think it a consequence of his own nature, that the Saviour has worn a body, but that, being incorporeal by nature, and word from the beginning, he has yet of the loving kindness and goodness of his own Father been manifested to us in a human body for our salvation. It is then proper for us to begin the treatment of this subject by speaking of the creation of the universe and of God its artificer, that so it may be duly perceived that the renewal of creation has been the work of the selfsame Word that made it at the beginning, for it will appear not in consonant with the Father to have wrought its salvation in him by whose means he made it. Of the making of the universe and the creation of all things, many have taken different views, and each man has laid down the law just as he pleased. For some say that all things have come into being of themselves, and in a chance fashion, as for example the Epicureans, who tell us in their self-contempt that universal providence does not exist, speaking right in the face of obvious fact and experience. For if, as they say, everything has had its beginning of itself and independently of providence, it would follow that everything had come into mere being so as to be alike and not distinct. For in virtue of the unity of body, it would follow that everything must be sun or moon, and in the case of men it would follow that the whole must be hand or eye or foot. But as it is, this is not so. On the contrary, we see a distinction of sun, moon, and earth, and again, in the case of human bodies, of foot, hand, and head. Now such separate arrangement as this tells us not of their having come into being of themselves, but shows that a cause preceded them, from which cause it is possible to apprehend God also as the maker and orderer of all. But others, including Plato, who is in such repute among the Greeks, argue that God has made the world out of matter previously existing, and without beginning. For God could have made nothing, had not the material existed already, just as the wood must exist already at hand for the carpenter, to enable him to work at all. But in so saying, they know not that they are investing God with weakness. For if he is not himself the cause of the material, but makes things only of previously existing material, he proves to be weak, because unable to produce anything he makes without the material, just as it is without doubt a weakness of the carpenter not to be able to make anything required without his timber. For, ex hypothesi, had not the material existed, God would not have made anything. And how could he in that case be called maker and artificer, if he owes his ability to make to some other source, namely to the material? So that if this be so, God will be, on their theory, a mechanic only, and not a creator out of nothing. If, that is, he works at existing material, but is not himself the cause of the material. For he could not in any sense be called creator unless he is creator of the material of which the things created have in their turn been made. But these sectaries imagine to themselves a different artificer of all things other than the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, in deep blindness even as to the words they use. For whereas the Lord says to the Jews, "Have ye not read that from the beginning he which created them made them male and female, and said, For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother, and shall cleave to his wife, and they twain shall become one flesh," and then, referring to the Creator, says, "What therefore God hath joined together, let not man put asunder." How come these men to assert that the creation is independent of the Father? Or if, in the words of John, who says, "Making no exception, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made," how could the artificer be another, distinct from the Father of Christ? Thus do they vainly speculate. But the godly teaching and the faith according to Christ brands their foolish language as godlessness, for it knows that it was not spontaneously, because forethought is not absent, nor of existing matter, because God is not weak, but that out of nothing, and without its having any previous existence, God made the universe to exist through his word. As he says, firstly through Moses, "In the beginning God created the heaven and the earth." Secondly, in the most edifying book of the Shepherd, "First of all, believe that God is one, which created and framed all things, and made them to exist out of nothing." To which also Paul refers when he says, "By faith we understand that the worlds have been framed by the word of God, so that what is seen hath not been made out of things which do appear. For God is good, or rather is essentially the source of goodness, nor could one that is good be niggardly of anything, whence, grudging existence to none, he has made all things out of nothing by his own word, Jesus Christ our Lord. And among these, having taken a special pity, above all things on earth, upon the race of men, and having perceived its inability, by virtue of the condition of its origin, to continue in one stay, he gave them a further gift, and he did not barely create man, as he did after the irrational creatures on the earth, but made them after his own image, giving them a portion even of the power of his own word. So that, having, as it were, a kind of reflection of the word, and being made rational, they might be able to abide ever in blessedness, living the true life which belongs to the saints in paradise. But knowing once more how the will of man could sway to either side, in anticipation he secured the grace given them by a law and by the spot where he placed them. For he brought them into his own garden and gave them a law, so that, if they kept the grace and remained good, they might still keep the life in paradise, without sorrow or pain or care, besides having the promise of incorruption in heaven, but that, if they transgressed and turned back and became evil, they might know that they were incurring that corruption in death which was theirs by nature, no longer to live in paradise, but cast out of it from that time forth to die and to abide in death and in corruption. Now this is that of which Holy Writ also gives warning, saying in the person of God, "Of every tree that is in the garden, eating, thou shalt eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, ye shall not eat of it, but on the day that ye eat, dying ye shall die." But by "dying ye shall die," what else could be meant than not dying merely, but also abiding ever in the corruption of death? You are wondering, perhaps, for what possible reason, having proposed to speak of the incarnation of the Word, we are at present treating of the origin of mankind. But this, too, properly belongs to the aim of our treatise. For in speaking of the appearing of the Saviour amongst us, we must needs speak also of the origin of men, that you may know that the reason of his coming down was because of us, and that our transgression called forth the loving kindness of the Word, that the Lord should both make haste to help us and appear among men. For of his becoming incarnate we were the object, and for our salvation he dealt so lovingly as to appear and be born even in a human body. Thus then God has made man, and willed that he should abide in incorruption, but men, having despised and rejected the contemplation of God, and devised and contrived evil for themselves, as was said in the former treatise, received the condemnation of death with which they had been threatened, and from thenceforth no longer remained as they were made, but were being corrupted according to their devices, and death had the mastery over them as king. for transgression of the commandment was turning them back to their natural state, so that just as they have had their being out of nothing, so also, as might be expected, they might look for corruption into nothing in the course of time. For if, out of a former normal state of non-existence, they were called into being by the presence and loving kindness of the Word, it followed naturally that when men were bereft of the knowledge of God and were turned back to what was not, for what is evil is not, but what is good is, they should, since they derive their being from God who is, be everlastingly bereft even of being, in other words, that they should be disintegrated and abide in death and corruption. For man is by nature mortal, inasmuch as he is made out of what is not. But by reason of his likeness to him that is, and if he still preserved this likeness by keeping him in his knowledge, he would stay his natural corruption and remain incorrupt, as wisdom says, by taking heed to his laws is the assurance of immortality, but being incorrupt, he would live henceforth as God, to which I suppose the divine scripture refers when it says, I have said ye are gods, and ye are all sons of the Most Highest, but ye die like men and fall as one of the princes. For God has not only made us out of nothing, but he gave us freely by the grace of the Word a life in correspondence with God. But men, having rejected things eternal and by counsel of the devil, turned to the things of corruption, became the cause of their own corruption, being, as I said before, of nature corruptible, but destined by the grace following from partaking of the Word to have escaped their natural state had they remained good. For because of the Word dwelling with them, even their natural corruption did not come near them, as wisdom also says, God made man for incorruption, and as an image of his own eternity, but by envy of the devil death came into the world. But when this was come to pass, men began to die, while corruption thenceforward prevailed against them, gaining even more than its natural power over the whole race, inasmuch as it had, owing to the transgression of the commandment, the threat of the deity as a further advantage against them. For even in their misdeeds, men had not stopped short at any set limits, but gradually pressing forward, have passed on beyond all measure, having to begin with been inventors of wickedness, and called down upon themselves death and corruption, while later on, having turned aside to wrong and exceeding all lawlessness, and stopping at no one evil but devising all manner of new evils in succession, they have become insatiable in sinning. For there were adulteries everywhere, and thefts, and the whole earth was full of murders and plunderings. And as to corruption and wrong, no heed was paid to law, but all crimes were being practised everywhere, both individually and jointly. Cities were at war with cities, and nations were rising up against nations, and the whole earth was rent with civil commotions and battles, each man vying with his fellows in lawless deeds. Nor were even crimes against nature far from them, but, as the apostle and witness of Christ says, for their women changed the natural use into that which is against nature, and likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men working unseemliness, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was meet. For this cause, then, death, having gained upon men and corruption abiding upon them, the race of man was perishing, the rational man made in God's image was disappearing, and the handiwork of God was in process of dissolution. For death, as I said above, gained from that time forth a legal hold over us, and it was impossible to evade the law, since it had been laid down by God because of the transgression, and the result was in truth at once monstrous and unseemly. For it were monstrous, firstly, that God, having spoken, should prove false, that when once he had ordained that man, if he transgressed the commandment, should die the death, after the transgression man should not die, but God's word should be broken.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.